Let us pray. Mighty Redeemer, we thank you for your amazing sacrifice on the cross and the awesomeness of your resurrection. And though we have not seen your face or touched your wounds, fill our hearts with faith to cast aside all doubt and believe in your wondrous love. In your glorious name we pray, amen. Today's scripture comes from the book of John, chapter 20, verses 19 through 31. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciple when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my fingers where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe it." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your fingers here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." And then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to you.
Can't see my socks, can you? Okay, good. Sometime back, former talk show host Johnny Carson was invited to Harvard University to receive an award. After the ceremony, he agreed to answer some questions from members of the press. One reporter asked, "What would you like to have inscribed on your tombstone?" Carson thought for just a second and then answered with the words that he used before every commercial break on his television show. He wanted his tombstone to say, "I'll be right back." Throughout the pages of the Gospels, we see how much the disciples loved Jesus. They loved him so much they'd do anything for him. But that doesn't mean that they always understood what he was saying. Jesus told the disciples that he would be put to death and that he would be right back in 3 days. The disciples tried to understand, but for some reason they just didn't. So the disciples were very confused on that evening of the first Easter. They were still trying to make sense out of what had happened. They were meeting behind locked doors. They were afraid. They talked in muffled tones. What happened to Jesus could very well happen to them. Every time they heard a noise, they thought it was someone coming to haul them away to prison. It kind of reminds me of a football story that Dennis Waitley tells about a Fiesta Bowl a few years ago in which Penn State and Miami competed for the national title. Penn State eked out a 14-10 victory, at victory included a nail-biting goal line stand in the closing minutes of the game. Somehow, Penn State's stubborn defense managed to hold off Miami's talented quarterback, Vinny Testaverde, one last time to thwart the Hurricanes from a final desperate effort to pull out a victory. In the frenzied jubilation after that game, after the final gun, the TV cameras zoomed in on various players, including one of Penn State's All-American linebackers. He credited Penn State's hard-hitting defensive backs with the victory. He said, "Miami's receivers just didn't want to catch the ball. They heard footsteps all night long, and they just didn't want to get hit." I guess we could say that the disciples were hearing footsteps like that. They were very frightened. But suddenly, out of nowhere, Jesus appeared in their midst. He showed them his hands and his feet and greeted them with the familiar words, "Peace be with you." He had done that hundreds of times before. But their response probably wasn't very peaceful at all. I mean, no one was supposed to know where they were hiding. How did Jesus find them? And how did he enter without using the door? The disciples were anxious and afraid and uncertain of what would happen next. Yet here was the Master right in their midst, and he was alive. Slowly they began to calm down, and then they began to rejoice. Jesus' presence unlocks the doors of fear. That's the first thing that happens when people meet the risen Christ. He takes away fear. Just as when the disciples began to relax and then to rejoice, he is alive. Rebecca Manley Pippert recalls a time when she first came to faith. Up until that time, she had been afraid that if she surrendered her life to God, he would take away her identity. Even worse, she was afraid that she'd become somewhat strange in the process. She thought of other religious persons that she had known and wasn't sure that she wanted to be like them. She wondered what changes she'd have to make in her life. Would she have to give up her love for jazz music? Would she have to act religious all the time? Would her friends recognize her? Her worst fear was that her friends would reject her as having become slightly demented. In her mind, she would hear the taunts of her friends. "Too bad about Becky. She used to be so much fun." But Becky knew that something just wasn't right in her life. Something was missing. There was an inner restlessness, an emptiness, a longing that never seemed to leave her. Something was definitely missing, but she was afraid. Afraid of the changes that Christ would require of her. When she finally came to faith, though, Christ filled her emptiness and removed her fear. And she was filled with a newfound sense of joy. That's what happens when folks come to know the risen Lord. He unlocks the doors of fear. The disciples were in hiding, frightened, listening for footsteps. But he came among them and said, "Peace be with you." And notice what happened next. Jesus breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." This was Jesus' way of commissioning the disciples for the work that he needed them to do. The Holy Spirit, as you know, would not come on them with full power until later on that day of Pentecost. But Jesus was preparing them. getting them ready. They would no longer be disciples or learners, but they were going to be apostles, those sent on his behalf. They would now be putting their lives on the line as his representatives. Jesus knew what awaited his disciples in the days ahead. So he had unlocked the doors of fear in their lives. And now he was sending them into the world to unlock those doors for others. But first of all, he wanted them to have a sure foundation. He wanted them to have an assurance, an inner witness to the faith that they proclaimed. And so he breathed on them, saying, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Which brings us to the second thing that happens when we meet Christ. He gives us a sure foundation that will not crumble. I can't believe it, but about 90 years ago, Japan asked the famous American architect from Wisconsin, Frank Lloyd Wright, they asked him to design a hotel for Tokyo and to design it in a way that it would be capable of surviving an earthquake. Well, when Wright visited Japan to inspect the site where the Imperial Hotel was to be built, he was appalled to find that the soil there was only about 8 feet deep. Beneath that was 60 feet of soft mud that slipped and shook like jelly. And every test hole that he dug immediately filled up with water. Now, a lesser individual probably would have given up right there, but not Frank Lloyd Wright. Since the hotel was going to rest on fluid ground, Wright decided to build it like a ship. So instead of trying to keep the structure from moving during the quake, he incorporated features that would allow the hotel to ride out the shock. Wright knew that the major cause of destruction after an earthquake was fire, because water lines would break and there would be no way to put out fire. So in this case, he insisted that a large outdoor pool be built in the courtyard of this hotel, just in case. So on September 1st, 1923, Tokyo had the greatest earthquake in its history. There were fires all over the city, and 140,000 people died. Back then, news reports were slow in getting to the United States. One newspaper wanted to print the story that the Imperial Hotel had been destroyed, as rumor had it. But when a reporter phoned Frank Lloyd Wright about it, he said they could print the story if they like, but they'd only have to retract it later. He knew the hotel would not collapse. Shortly afterward, Wright got a telegram from Japan. The Imperial Hotel was completely undamaged. And when the fires that raged all around the hotel threatened to spread, bucket brigades were used to keep the structures around the hotel wetted down with water from that hotel's pool that he had planned. Frank Lloyd Wright knew about foundations, and so does Jesus. He does not want his followers out in the world witnessing to something that they have not really experienced for themselves. So he gives us the gift of the Holy Spirit as an internal witness. We do not have to simply depend on a story that we've heard long ago. God is forever fresh in our hearts.